That's his name. Carried me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton and...
Catherine Knight, who uses the pen name K.I. Knight, is an international award-winning author, genealogist, historian, public speaker, cemetery preservationist, and a land development consultant. Knight has logged over 20,000 hours researching and documenting the first Africans who arrived in Virginia during 1619. In 2016, as an advisory board member for Project 1619, she co-curated the 1619 First African Landing exhibit at the Hampton History Museum. Her literary work includes Fate and Freedom, a 5-star gold medal historical series, as well as Unveiled, the 20 and Odd, just released in May 2019. Currently, Catherine is developing a national library program for the Afro-American Historical and Genealogical Society for the 1619-2019 400th anniversary commemoration. She also serves and is a member of many genealogical and historical societies throughout the country, including the National, Florida State, and Virginia Genealogy Societies, to name a few of the many groups that are deeply involved in promoting American history. It was my distinct pleasure to interview Catherine, who, as you'll see in this interview, offers stunning information from an enormous amount of painstaking research. That research has in turn shed light on a history that has been largely misstated at best. For that reason alone, Miss Knight is the perfect person to have interviewed for this fourth installment of my series concerning the pillars of 17th century Virginia. Well, Catherine, I'm really excited to have you here today and discuss quite a supercharged topic here, 17th century slavery in Virginia and some of the origins of that, especially surrounding the 20 and odd Negroes coming into 1619, some of the myths and the stories. And you've done a lot of work, a lot of research on setting the story straight. And recently you just came out with a book that is full of information regarding this particular topic. From what we know from the historical record, can you go ahead and please describe the events surrounding the 20 and odd Negroes and how they arrived here at Point Comfort, 1619?
In 1619, there was a war. A Portuguese had declared war on the kingdom of Ndongo. And when they did, they came through the kingdom and enslaved, captured, killed the bulk of the citizens. It was the kingdom of Ndongo, the Kabasa was the township, the head of the township there, and there was an international market there. That international market brought people from all over Africa. We find the kingdom of Longo, which is north of Congo, the kingdom of Congo, the kingdom of Ndongo, all of these people would have been in that market. So when the Portuguese came through, there was other people besides the kingdom of just Ndongo there. And I wanted to make that pertinent because Eventually it's going to come full circle. The Portuguese came through and enslaved them. They took them, they force marched them to the port of Luanda. And they were placed there until the ships arrived. They put them on the boats and they were shipped out. Now when they were shipped out, 350 Africans were aboard the San Juan Bautista, which was a Spanish ship. Many times people have said it's Portuguese. That is a misconception from a notation in Ingalls Sluder's work. But it was a Spanish ship, which is important because that's going to come back around too because of lawsuits and ongoing stuff in the future. When they were put aboard that ship was not a normal slave ship. It was much slender. The origins of that ship was actually from Japan. We have the actual specifications of the ship when it was built. There's a San Juan Bautista Museum in Japan. So we can duplicate that ship and know what it looked like, which is important because it was very slender. It was more like a man-of-war ship or a Spanish galleon. It was not a slave ship that they normally
like
would have put.
Seen, yes, yeah, 19th century.
It was much different. And because of that, They were much more crowded. There was much more illness. And by the time that they had gone from the port of Luanda and had made it to Jamaica, which was probably two-thirds of the way there, to the port of Veracruz where they were going, they had over 100 that had died. So the captain, his name was Captain Acuna, Captain Manuel Mendez de Acuna, and he stopped in Jamaica. He bought medicine, and he stayed there just probably a few days to a week, maybe, and to have the, allow them to get the medicine and recuperate. Then he went on his way and to continue on to Veracruz. Now, when he got 500 miles of the port of Veracruz, he noticed two warships tracking him, following him. There is notation of that. And anyway, those two warships end up pirating. They fire on the San Juan Bautista. I'm sure he gave up rather quickly because of his cargo. He had no way to defend himself.
Right.
And so those two warships, they basically pirated the Bautista. Now, they were not looking for Africans. Mm-hmm. They were looking for gold. And the reason we know that is because of the origin of the ship. The ship looked like a Spanish galleon. A Spanish galleon did not contain Africans. Slaves.
Right.
So we know that they were not looking for slaves unless they knew they were on there beforehand. That's the only way they could have known. But for the most pretense, you would have to think that they would not have known they were that it more or less would have they been looking for gold. So when they found the Africans, they said they had to make some kind of a profit. So they took 60 of those Africans, split them 30-30 on the two ships, and they went to the closest port that they knew of, which would be Virginia. Right. However, on the way to Virginia, coming around through the coast of Florida, they hit a storm. That storm separates the two ships. The mm-hmm. White Lion went to Bermuda. The Treasure got caught in the storm. Probably a mast was broken. Something happened because that ship, its speed went from probably 3 to 4 knots down to 3/4 of a knot.
Oh, wow.
So it lost, there was something that happened. And later on, 60 days later, is a notation that's made in Bermuda when it arrived in Bermuda that it was torn and weather beaten so bad, never likely to sail again. So yeah. We know that it got caught in that storm. Now, the Treasure, it took 30 days basically to get from Florida to Virginia. When it landed in Virginia, the White Lion had already arrived there. Mm-hmm. And they had basically sold 14 of the Africans to Governor Yardley and to the Cape Merchant, who was Abraham Piercy. We know that those 14 Africans, they remained on their plantation, those two, until their death in 1627 and 1628. We find them, those same Africans there. So from that point, when they arrived there, they were not enslaved. They were enslaved on the ship, you can say, because they were meant to be slaves right. in Veracruz. But when they landed in the English port here at Point Comfort, mm-hmm. they were no longer enslaved. They became more of an indentured servant. They're noted as servants. So from that point, they also, you have to realize, they were maritime contraband because they were stolen. Two English ships pirated them from a Spanish ship,
right.
which was highly illegal.
Right.
England was at peace with Spain, so therefore, it was total piracy. They weren't privateering. Mm-hmm. Now, one of them had an English, or had a mark, had a Dutch mark. And that's how it got twisted that it was a Dutch ship. It was really an English ship carrying a Dutch mark. Mm-hmm. But for an English ship to fire upon a Spanish ship was illegal. However, the Dutch mark gave it allowances
kind of
and allowed them
to
do
around.
It. Exactly.
Right. Right.
So you see in a lot of literature that a Dutch ship brought the first Africans.
Right.
It was really an English ship. We know who the names of it. Fast forward to January of that year. They landed August 25th, 24th, around that time period. Fast forward to January, there is the first letter from John Rolfe, the secretary of the company, to Edwin Sandys, who's the treasurer in England. When he sent that letter was so ambiguous. There was several things in it that caught my attention. One, it was named a Dutch ship. Two, it was a Mr. Marmaduke, who was the pilot. His real name was Marmaduke Rayner. He was quite known throughout all of the English ports, including Virginia. In January of the same year, the same time the letter was being written, how I know it was an ambiguous letter is because Governor Yardley personally recommended Marmaduke Rayner to explore the Carolinas. And what he was doing was getting him out of reach
sure.
of anybody being able to him to testify of what happened.
Right.
So Rayner was sent off. into the Carolinas for several years. At that point in March, those three significant things were Mr. Marmaduke, the 20 and odd. That number in Virginia, everybody counted everything. Everything. Whether Absolutely. It was grain, it was tobacco, whatever it was, everything was counted. The numbers were counted. You didn't see 20 and odd anywhere. So I started looking at that. And when you look at who arrived when, 20 and odd didn't exist. It was totally an ambiguous, made up number.
Okay.
Because when the white lion arrived, they only had 14.
I was going to ask you, you mentioned the 14.
Yes.
So where did...
Because when the white lion went to Bermuda, they had 30. Mm-hmm. There is documentation on August 12th that they arrived. Four of the crewmen and two of the Africans were detained in Somerset, Bermuda. So now we're down to 28 Africans. 14 of them, the captain tried, there's documentation that says that he tried to sell 14 of the Africans in exchange for water and victual, which is food.
Right.
They denied him, and that documentation is in Bermuda too. However, 2 days later, a Captain Kirby finds 14 Africans floating on the seas. Now, when Captain Chope left of the White Lion, when he left Bermuda, he was so angry, he said he would just soon throw 14 of the Africans overboard than watch them wither. Mm-hmm. So whether he sold them and they didn't want to say because they knew where they came from, the Spanish pirated ship, or whether they actually came from Kirby that he may have traded them, I don't know. That is never going to, I don't think we'll ever know that answer.
Right.
But 14 of them did go to Bermuda and they stayed mm-hmm. in Bermuda. So when the white lion arrives, he's only got 14 to trade.
Okay.
So we know that number is ambiguous.
So it's not 20 and odd.
It is not
20 and odd.
It's
more likely the 14.
It's 14 to begin with. Now, when the treasurer arrives, it arrived after the white lion arrived. The white lion went to Bermuda and to Virginia, and it took that long for the treasurer to arrive because it was had destroyed damage. So when it arrives, it is sent off because they didn't want the Earl of Warwick's ship to be known as being pirating because mm-hmm. his license, he had the license from a Duke of Savoy. It's an Italian
right,
mark.
Right.
But the Duke of Savoy had made peace with Spain, so now it was piracy. If that ship, they had purchased those Africans from that ship, that was a pirated ship, and it would have caused major problems, which it did anyway.
It was a headache for the Virginia Company
it was.
At the time.
So they sent it off. They sent it, and he left. He went mm-hmm. to Bermuda. When they arrived in Bermuda, there's documentation that says that 29 Africans arrived on the treasure. So we're down one.
Mm-hmm.
Whether that one got off the ship in Virginia to allow for his passage to leave instead of him being detained, I don't know. Did the person die on the voyage? That is highly likely because I believe this is the longest middle passage of record. Because those Africans were still not done. They mm-hmm. went to Bermuda. Now, from August, at the time that they knew that the treasure had pirated these Africans, till January, you have 3.5 months, basically.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a week to go between Virginia
right.
and Bermuda.
Right.
There were people covering the treasure in Bermuda and in Virginia. They had to make up a tale. They had to camouflage the whole situation, and that's what they did.
Okay.
And it was quite difficult to put it all back together. They did a very good job. But those Africans, how we get to the 32, which is on the census in March of 1620, the Africans that were on the treasure that arrived in Bermuda, there was about 8 or 9 of them that were already lent out. But those Africans were sent back in February to hide them. They thought that's how they got the number 20 and odd. When that letter was written in January, they thought that that would cover 32,
gotcha.
But it didn't. There was more sent back. I would say there was probably 18 of them that were shipped back. Those were all from the San Juan Bautista. Those were all pirated. Some of them stayed in Bermuda. There was about 8 of them. Plus the original 14 stayed there. Now, mm-hmm. when the White Lion left Virginia after September 30th, which is the last documentation we have of him here in Virginia, when he left, he went back to Bermuda, picked up his 4 crewmen and 2 Africans. Those
okay.
2 Africans went to England with him, and
right.
we have them returning from England back to Virginia 2 or 3 years later. So we know that that took place.
We know where they went, for
yes.
sure. Yes.
So now we have 32 Africans, because mm-hmm. 18 and 14, there's your numbers.
Sure.
But that's how they all got here. And it was via, trip. That was a long trip. They went from Luanda to almost to Veracruz, which is, right. You're looking at 12,000 nautical miles. Then you're going to go from there to Virginia, then mm-hmm. to Bermuda, and mm-hmm. back to Virginia. So mm-hmm. you're over 15,000 nautical miles easy. Sure. And that quite possibly could be the first and longest middle passage of record.
And we're talking a number of years there. I mean, it's early 1620s by that point.
It was, right. Well, it was a five-month period to get them all back. Or, okay. You know, the ones that came, the 32.
Now, where did they go after they eventually did settle in Virginia? The prevailing narrative is that they were all sold into slavery. However,
they were not sold into slavery. They couldn't have been sold into slavery because when the two ships pirated the San Juan Bautista, Captain Acuna mm-hmm. was actually the cousin. This is more back to my cluster genealogy.
Sure.
He was the cousin of the Spanish ambassador to King James's court. So he had King James's ear, and now we have a real problem because he filed a lawsuit. First mm-hmm. of all, he opened for questioning. He wanted to know exactly what happened. The Virginia Company started to question everybody involved. Then it went to a lawsuit. When that lawsuit happened, everything basically stopped. Those Africans sat, they were exactly where they were. None of them really moved or exchanged hands other than through contracted issues. Mm-hmm. We can talk about in a minute. When those Africans came, so we have 14, we have 8 at Governor Yardley's, we have 6 at Piercy's. Now, the first child, it's always been said that it was William Tucker. That is not true. He was the first child baptized on English soil. The first child born belonged to one of the Africans at Piercy's plantation at 1400. Her name was Frances. She ends up becoming Frances Driggers. Her son's name, and she's listed as Negro woman with young child of hers in the 1623 census before William is born and listed. So we know he is the first child. Eventually, I can put together the legal documents many years later that his name was Peter George. So he was the first child born in Virginia that was the African. William was the first child baptized, we have of record.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they, the Tuckers, are known as the first family. Frances, we do not know who the father of that child was.
Okay.
I do not believe he was one of the Africans there at that plantation because I know who those were and I can decipher that that wasn't their child. I don't know how. There may have been someone, another African that was there. His name could have been George. I don't have an answer to that part of it. But he was the first. Peter George was the first one there. Now, there were other Africans that came. When they came back, I believe that they were given two Robert Rich's helpers, so to speak. Those that were helping cover up, who was William Ewens, E-W-E-N-S. Okay. There are several, like the Tuckers for one, because they ended up with one. Actually, the man that wrote the letter back to the Virginia Company for the first time, he ended up with Angela. That was probably his incentive to skew the letter so it didn't look quite right. He was helping. Many of them actually helped to hide them. Now, we don't find a lot of them even on the censuses, but we do find them on the patents.
Right. We found a few like Angela on censuses, and that's why everybody's talking about.
Right. Yeah. And then we also find 4 of them at Bennett's plantation. You have to understand there's other connections Bennett had. One of them was with Captain Chope. Mm-hmm. That's how I know Margaret got there. He came back in 1622 right after the massacre and brought her on the White Lion. There's documentation of that ship arriving. There's also documentation of, get this, Captain Chope actually did Robert Bennett's genealogy, and it is in the documents with him saying that he actually did it in England.
Yeah.
So I tied those two together. The other tie was Lord Rich, or Robert Rich, the Earl of Warwick. He was a Protestant, or
a Puritan.
A Puritan.
Right.
The only other Puritans in all on the James River at that time was Bennett's plantation.
Right.
So anybody associated, and those Africans did end up there. The ones that came via England through Lord Rich or Chope. So that was how they got to Bennett's plantation.
Okay.
There was one at King's Mill, which was Edward. He becomes Edward Mozingo. And he has, you know, has children, which are referenced in the book. But there's several of them that are in primary locations that had people that were all attached to and had some incentive to hide the piracy. Mm. And that's how they got them. Now, we can follow those Africans later on, and that's how I deciphered who those Africans were later on, because they weren't named early on. But by 1635, well, in 1628, when Yardley dies, because he's the one that didn't name them. The other ones I got first names from Piercy. But Yardley didn't name his at all. But we can trace who they sold to, because in 1635, they start showing up as headwrights. And it also has a release of indenture attached with those. And then 7 years later from that headwright, they own property.
Which in and of itself, that shatters the myth that they were slaves from the beginning. Because by 1635, they're owning land. They're being treated as equal citizens with equal rights.
Actually, they become very valued. They raise livestock. They have the horses. They raise the horses.
Now, these are things they understood from Africa that they brought with them.
The knowledge.
Right.
They brought the knowledge of being able to raise the crops, grow the food. They knew. They were very acclimatized to the heat also.
Sure, sure.
And people coming from England weren't.
Not
definitely.
At all.
So that was a big deal, just being able to acclimate to this area. Between 1619 and 1623, when that census was taken, 4,600 people came that Sandys had sent as indentured servants, and 4,500 had died. So I question, and one of the big things in my book is, how did when the Africans arrived, it was noted that the settlement was starving. Mm-hmm. So they had this knowledge that they brought with them. But in 1622, after the native uprising that happened, and it killed a third of the population, and then from 80 plantations up and down the James River, they were condensed into 8 to make a defense against the natives.
Right.
And if you look at those 8 plantations where they were and who was on them, what I did is I looked at the list of the living on every single person. There's documentation that shows where those people came from, if it was off the streets, out of the prisons, whether they were orphaned. There is information that can tell you about these people. And what I did is I looked at every one of them to determine what they knew, where they came from. If they were off the streets of England, they didn't know how to grow corn.
Right.
They didn't know how to grow food. They didn't know how to take care of themselves in the wilds of Virginia. There's no way. So when they came here, who did know was the Africans. And I've had a lot of pushback against this, but I believe after the massacre that the Africans provided the food, the livestock to keep Virginia alive. If those Africans wouldn't have been there, I'm not sure we could be sitting in South Canada.
It makes sense, because when you see some of the statements after that massacre, essentially the Englishmen that are around, they're just dithering about. They don't know what to do.
That's right.
They're going from one place to the next. Food is gone. They're complaining. I forget the one young man's name. He had just got sent over here. He was asking his parents to send him food, and we never hear from him again after maybe food arrived, maybe it didn't. He dies somewhere soon thereafter. And that's one of many stories of what you just said. More than 4,000 die in this period. But what you don't see from the record we do know are those Africans dying at the same rate. They're still around. They're still around later in the 1620s,
many,
as we know.
Many, many years later.
And we see them in the 1630s and the 40s. So
I see them all the way into the 1660s.
I think that argument has validity to it in the fact that they knew how to survive and take care of themselves and others, whereas the Englishmen didn't.
I think they would have taught them, the Englishmen, how to grow food and to take care of livestock.
Makes sense.
There's no, I just don't see anybody else that had the knowledge at that time listed on the list of the living. Now, there's Burgesses there that had been there for years, but do you think they're going to be out there growing corn?
Certainly not.
So I write them off. I'm down to about 10% of the people on the list of the living that had any knowledge at all.
That wouldn't have been enough to support the colony. No. Certainly not with the type of farming that was taking place after 1622. That's an interesting strain to add to early 17th century Virginia. It really is, to show the influence and the impact these Africans did have. But in a free manner, because they didn't have to do this. They could have said, starve to death. We know how to take care of ourselves. Just
right.
Do it on your own. They didn't do that from what we know.
I think it's because of the natives.
Okay.
I think that they could have had concern. Could they have been killed?
Okay.
Now, I don't believe that any Africans died in the native uprising at all.
Okay.
There's one listed on the list of the living and dead in 1623, mm-hmm. but I think that was because of when the Abigail came in late 1622, it brought disease. And
okay.
I think that one would have died from some type of disease that the Abigail brought.
You think of Bennett Plantation, or Bennett's Welcome as it was mm-hmm. called, did suffer quite a large proportion of that massacre. Can't remember. I don't think anybody on that list that we know of who died was African. That's one that's popping off in my mind.
No, there's none.
I didn't think so.
No, there's, I think, 47 or 53 people that died at Bennett's Plantation. Mm-hmm. There was all but five, I think, and Anthony was one of them. Margaret had not arrived yet, and there's two others on the census of 1623, the list of the living, which was Francis and Peter.
Okay.
Those were the two I was telling you that there was a contractual event that happened, and what that was Piercy was required, because he had these Africans at Florida, to lend effort to the building of the fort. There was a fort being built next to Bennett's Plantation called the Lookout Fort. And that was supposed to give early warning, or give them some type of ability to be aware that they were coming. And Francis and Peter are transferred from Piercy back to Bennett's Plantation. The following year, they're back at Piercy's in 1624-25 muster. So we know that that's how they moved, and that's who it was.
So those records are certainly not lost.
No.
They're there and easy I shouldn't say easy, but they're easy now because you put them in your book.
That's right.
That's great. That's great. What do we know from the record of any of the other 14 now? Right. Well, I'll call them the 20 and odd, because that's what everybody knows them
as.
They're
definitely the 20 and odd. And as you see, that's the title of my book is Unveiled. But that's a play on words, because it's a total ambiguous statement. What happened to the others? The Piercy and Yeardley, those were the 14. There was seven now because of Peter. He became the seventh African at Piercy's. They actually, when Piercy died, he was married. And he had two daughters. His wife remarried Samuel Matthews pretty quickly.
Right.
And when she did, in Piercy's will, it states that she was the executor, and it was to be split up three ways, the will, how his everything was to be split. Yeah. Now, nothing was split until after she died. She took all of them with them, her, and she went to Matthew's Plantation, and that's where she stayed until. Now, we find those Africans in 1635 beginning to become headwrights. Mm-hmm. So whether she sold them to someone, or if at the time that she died that they were transferred, I don't know, because there's not a record of that. It's where I'm finding the record is once they have been released from the indenture in certain ones. But
he was one of the big ones. Right.
Now, Governor Yeardley, he actually owned Florida Plantation to begin with. He sold it to Piercy. Mm-hmm. Now, when he sold it to Piercy, he left and went back to Jamestown. He took two of them with him. Those two were women, women are the hardest to identify. I can tell you possibles. I have possibles in my book, but those two, I have to say, I cannot specifically say who they were. The others I can, though, because we can trace them. Governor Yeardley owned 1,300 acres on Northampton County. When he sold the property to Piercy, he took his Africans and put them at the eastern shore. So, but then we can see them on the eastern shore, and we see those same Africans becoming free and becoming headwrights and then purchasing property. And there's only a few of them. And right. that's how we identify and we know that's where they came from, because you can literally track them going from one place to another. There's three different families that they were with on the Eastern Shore, and through wills and different information, you can track them. So they all end up on the Eastern Shore. Pierce ends up over there, and so does Governor Yardley's Africans okay. end up there. Okay. So a bulk of them do.
And then they start owning land themselves. We know that land. By the 1640s for yes. sure, they're owning yes. land. Were they owning other Africans or even other whites or other Indians?
Both.
Okay.
Anthony Johnson, he had one African servant.
Right.
Who was John, and he ends up going to court, and mm-hmm. that he
That's
becomes
John
enslaved.
Kazar.
Yes, he becomes enslaved for life. Then there was two Englishmen, though, mm-hmm. that were also in Anthony Johnson's Patton. And okay. that's where you find and know that he was the master, and these were head rights.
Right.
He did not own any natives, but okay. natives were owned okay. and were servants throughout the colony.
Sure.
There were.
So if the 20 and odd weren't the first slaves in English Virginia, then when does it seem most likely that slavery starts to begin?
Slavery started to... Okay, Massachusetts, it started in right. 1631.
And some of the other colonies have it. Right.
That was the first colony to have it.
Okay.
Guess who was the money man behind the Massachusetts? It was Massachusetts, but it was also called the New England Colony. Robert Rich, the Earl of Warwick. He was the money man. When he left the Virginia Company, when all this started happening, right. Edwin Sandys challenged him. He said, okay, fine, I'm taking my money and I'm out of here. He formed the New England Colony. That's where the first slaves were enslaved okay. in 1631, the first laws. Okay. Now, if you fast forward that to 1640, 1638, 1639, 1640, that's when everything starts to change and you see a division between the Africans and the Europeans. In 1639...
Both in New England and here in Virginia.
But in Virginia, you see where the first law is recorded that Africans are not allowed to have weapons, as okay. in guns. The Englishmen are required to carry them. Mm-hmm. Africans are allowed. So there's your first division. Also, another one was in 1639. There was three servants that ran away. One was African, two were European. The two Europeans, once they were caught, received a year or two added on to their indenture. The African was enslaved for life, basically. Okay. That is the first one we see. And then 10 years later, you see Anthony Johnson taking someone to court, which
right.
was a neighbor, and to retain John Caesar.
Okay.
So... that's really when it starts, but it's still not in full effect until
right.
1661.
It's not
formalized. That's when it's really going to come about.
Right. So we do start seeing it somewhat there in the 1640s. 1660s, we see it, as you mentioned, different mm-hmm. court cases we know of. Was it Margaret Johnson? Forgive me, the name escapes me. African woman, she was trying to say that she couldn't be enslaved because she had a white father. Is that...
That was Elizabeth Key. And she actually ended up marrying her attorney, whose mm-hmm. last name was Grimstead. But yes, and that's what happens. Whenever there was two Africans that really knew the legal system, and they were appointed. One was a clerk, which was John Gowan. The other okay. one was Benjamin Dahl. Benjamin Dahl was in Surrey County, and then John was across on the north side of the river.
Okay.
But we find them being appointed as legal representatives for people. And we find them, there's documents drawn there, and they're representing different legal issues. Now, as soon as the Africans would find their way legally to be free and to actually have it documented like Elizabeth Key did,
right.
immediately the Europeans instilled that law that changed so that following that it wouldn't happen again. They had so much knowledge, they had become such a commodity. Let me back up to 1619 when they arrived. Not a single plantation had made a profit. 1621, you see the first plantations, and guess where they are? It's Piercy's plantation.
Right.
That's where the Africans were. And they started seeing that they had these profits, mm-hmm. and that's what it was all about, was the profits they thought they could make, and they had not made any to date.
Mm-hmm.
So they recognized at that point that the Africans had all this knowledge.
Right.
And with that knowledge, is why they wanted to retain them. Without them, they right. couldn't make the profits. So it was really their knowledge that really pulled them into slavery. It was, they wanted to retain them, and they did everything they could to right. keep them. And that's right. any law that they could get around, they would change the law so that the next one couldn't.
So by the 1660s, we do start to see those court cases where yep. it becomes more of a documented evidence that slavery is there. But it's still not formalized yet. There are a few other things that do take place. Bacon's Rebellion, for one. Mm-hmm. Africans sided with Nathaniel Bacon, correct? Mm-hmm. And then after that, well, they're seen as siding with the traitor. So right. let's go ahead and nail this down a little bit more. But we still don't see slavery completely formalized, until the 1690s, then 1705, I believe. Mm-hmm. So by that point in time, slavery had already, I shouldn't say it missed the 17th century in Virginia, but it's not what we know of it as in the 18th century and then in the 19th century.
It's not slavery as we know it. Slavery had to become. It had to, right. it didn't exist in England. Actually, there's two instances in Bermuda in the mm-hmm. early 1619, 1621 that we see the word slavery. And those are the only two instances. The first one was where a African man was enslaved for a period of time. And it was probably no more than a year. His name okay. was Simon, and he was enslaved to the colony because he had hurt a child. Now, okay. I don't know what hurt meant, but he had brought...
That was punishment for crime.
Now, the second one was also punishment, but it was a white man. The governor had instilled him enslaved to the colony because he had gone against the governor's wishes politically.
Okay.
Wow. So he became a slave for a year to the okay. colony. So you see that it's punishment. Mm-hmm. It did not right. exist as an institution like we know slavery back in the 1800s.
Right.
So you really have to take off your historical glasses contemporary and go back, because it had to evolve.
Right.
Slavery didn't just come to the shores of Virginia, it evolved.
And as we're saying here, not in 1619, maybe a little bit in the beginning in the 1640s, and then more so 1660s, and then on. And it evolves. Yeah,
evolves.
There's a number of things that happen. You mentioned Africans are seen as valuable for mm-hmm. their knowledge. Then they're seen as siding with Nathaniel Bacon, being rebellious. And then we start to see the law come down against them, yeah. Which is extremely unfortunate. But even at that point, many of those Africans later on in the early 18th century, we see them as still holding very prominent positions, don't we, throughout mm-hmm. Virginia and in some of the leading first family homes and such.
They became the first free people of color. Mm-hmm. And their families are the ones that we know as the free people mm-hmm. of color. And you can watch them and track them all the way into the 1890s, to current day.
And that's some of the work that you've been doing recently as well. Can you expound on that a little bit more? You were mentioning something with DNA before we started to record.
Well, I want to go back to when I first started this in 2006. Mm-hmm. It started with genealogy, finding my husband's ancestors, which okay. was Margaret Cornish, that led me back to these first mm-hmm. Africans. And I did his DNA, mm-hmm. and I found a small bit of African DNA. It was a blend of Bantu, Bianchi pygmy,
okay.
and West African. And there was an old, old DNA portion, which was called SAN, S-A-N. It's the oldest DNA, African DNA, that's out there. It was a mixture of those three, or four. And that mixture is what when I started looking at it, I started finding in other people that also had the paper path back to these mm-hmm. Africans. I ended up with about 2,000 people in my
wow.
database. And you literally can look and you can pick out these little tiny bits. Now, we're trying to come up with an algorithm okay. so that we can, you can put it in the computer and you can just automatically, the algorithm will pick it and see it, and you'll see that you descend from them. But currently, what I have had to do is I've had to do it by hand. And you
sure.
have to find them. If you have a match, then you have to look at that match to see what that DNA is, and then determine if that DNA matches others mm-hmm. that have that paper path. We have found several of those the paper path for those Africans and the DNA that matches.
That's amazing.
It.
That's
is amazing.
It really is something you couldn't do 50 years ago, but now with modern science, we can.
I don't think I could have put this book together 50 years ago, because
sure.
I literally had to use information from archives all over the world. I had Japan, Portugal, mm-hmm. Veracruz, Mexico. You had Spain.
Sure.
You had England. You had Brazil. I mean, there's so much that went into it that I don't think you could have done it
and that's,
before the internet.
That's perhaps big reason why a lot of this fuller picture of the story is lost is because typically historians, we like to take small bits and just focus on those small bits, and we forget about all the other interconnecting, interweaving world events that are going on. And just in the story that you're mentioning here, from Luanda, Angola, mm-hmm. almost to Mexico, mm-hmm. there's Jamaica in there, Bermuda, Virginia, England. They're covering a wide swath of land. They're gonna touch many different cultures and peoples, even in just that circle, and then those peoples are already all touching the rest of the world as well. Just phenomenal. It blew my mind when we first started talking about this. And knowing now that we can trace DNA, and a lot of the archaeology is trying to do that and trying to really trace and put this puzzle together. Fascinating. Where can one learn more about the 20 and odd, and then also about 17th century Virginia slavery, or just slavery in general?
I am the chair for the African American Historical and Genealogical Society for the 16-19 400 mm-hmm. commemoration. Being the library chair, what we are trying to do is we have a collection of books, sure. of journals, of articles that we will have in, this is our goal, in every library across America, that we want it in a commemoration section. We will have the books, we will have, with the collection, we are filming tomorrow, actually, okay. a documentary. It's a project where several of us are getting together mm-hmm. and we're filming to put together for this. So we'll have a documentary. There'll be a screen there. You can sit down and watch the documentary. My wish is when we get this whole DNA set up within hopefully the next year, we'll have it ready to go, that you can put your raw DNA into a computer base
okay.
right there in the library and know if you descend from those Africans.
That's amazing.
That's my goal. That's what we want to sure. get to. But in that collection, I will have, there will be every book. Books are in my household are kind of a touchy subject because when the doorbell rings and Amazon delivers, my husband rolls his eyes and is like, are you kidding me?
Every my wife's time, the same way. More books.
Every time I find, even if it's just a one little word or, right. or their name in a book, I have to have the book.
Right.
Because I have to say, when somebody asks you, you know, where did you get this from? I got the answer.
Right.
So I can give you that information, but I have quite the collection of library books. All sure. of that information will be in a library. Mm-hmm. And I hope there's one in every public library across America.
Okay. And then you just recently put out a book. It came out, what, a week ago now? Mm-hmm. The 18th, I believe?
18th.
Tell us a little bit more about that as well.
Well, the book is, I've actually pulled the information from a research companion. I started in 2006 and I wrote a series of novels. Mm-hmm. But before I wrote those novels, I wrote it as nonfiction. I hated it. I couldn't convey the pain, the fear, right. the terror that these Africans would have went through in their right. homeland when they got here. You find every color of skin causing them trauma.
Right.
Whether they're white, whether they're owned from their own kingdom in Africa, whether they were Portuguese. I can't imagine what they went through of who could they trust. So, but I wanted to convey how these people felt. And so I wrote the story as fiction. It's about 90% factual. Mm-hmm. I have to hold it out as fiction because I wrote it in first person. So you okay. could convey this,
sure.
the pain or, you know, the emotion. But with that series, there is a research companion. In the research companion, it gives all the information, being cluster genealogy on the Europeans, on the Africans, on the everything I could find that was pertinent to the story is in that research companion.
Okay.
Once that comes out next year, that'll be a huge plus for lots and lots of people. But from that book, I took and made Unveil.
Okay.
Because I kept hearing lots and lots of stories that weren't correct, and I
right.
especially about slavery. And I wanted people to know, these people need to be able to take their true spot in history. They probably, and I would be willing to bet that they saved Virginia during that time frame, mm-hmm. that from 1622, 1623, 24, that was a very significant to keep people alive. And they were dying left and right from out
right.
of England. And so I wanted to make sure that the truth was there. And after all the hours that I had studied and done the research, I couldn't stand any longer it not being the truth that's being put out. So I decided
right.
to take the information that was really pertinent to how they arrived and who they were and about the slavery, and I made Unveiled out of that research,
certainly.
The information from the research companion. But the research companion has still got a lot. It's got currently 743 pages, and I have about another 100 to add. So it's going to be
great.
Quite thick.
Yes, ma'am. That's great. I'm excited about that. Looking forward to that. You mentioned the other work you're doing. Is there a website for?
There's several websites. I have a genealogy blog website, which is www.kinfolkdetective.com.
Okay, I'll put all this on the show notes page for this episode.
Okay, so. My publishing website is firstfreedompublishing.com. Okay. There you can actually just Google me, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of information that I've put out there. But sure. You can definitely find all of it out there and where to order the books, and they're on Amazon, Barnes & Noble.
We'll certainly look for the show notes page, and I'll have a lot of information there, especially a link to your new book here, Unveiled. Fascinating stories. I'm really looking forward to being the history nerd that I am. I'm really looking forward to the research companion very much.
It'll be something.
Certainly.
It really will.
Well, Catherine, I really appreciate it. This has been highly enlightening and just fascinating. I'm sure we could talk for hours here. For those who want to know a lot more, let's get on the show notes page. Let's find your books and other work that you're going to link as well.
Yeah.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you again for supporting the podcast. It's greatly appreciated. Please continue to spread the word and help this colony to keep growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and visit the website. Sharing episodes and other work is the best way to expand the community. Another way to greatly aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you have yet to do so, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Doing so helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. It also helps me to know what I need to improve on in future episodes. If you would like to support the work financially, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPOD to see the choices and rewards being offered for your generosity. And please, join me next time as we continue walking through Virginia's history. Do do bad, do 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 do